Welcome everyone to this next panel of Tech and Innovation Summit 2021. We are in the third stage, which is the final stage of our day, and this panel is about the changing dynamics of money. And to talk about it, we have with us Mr. Ashish Singhal, co-founder and CEO CoinSwitch, and we have Mr. Madhusudan Ekambaram, CEO CreditBee and co-founder Faith. Mr. Anand Kumar Bajaj, founder, MD and CEO, PayNearby. Mr. Rajesh Raju, managing director, Lari Capital. And Mr. David Goding, managing partner, Jungle Ventures. And to lead the session, we have with us Mr. Ashish Kapadia, partner, Loom Ventures. Ashish, over to you.
Hi, very good afternoon and a warm welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure going back and working with some of the friendly faces that we have been, and good to know a few others who we have not met. So thank you once again, Saurabh and Entrepreneur India team. The thought process was to spend some time trying to talk about the overall future, the way we look at fintech. We are all investors, stroke founders, stroke entrepreneurs in more ways than one. And the idea would not be to try and just gesticulate on only about things which we are hallucinating or dreaming about. But the thought process would be to try and connect the dots and try and put forth our views on how we see the scenario shaping up specifically with respect to fintech as an industry. So just to get going, my quick thoughts on the vertical, the way I have seen fintech over the last few years, I have kind of felt that we are moving towards an era where fintech is no longer going to remain a vertical. I do feel that the horizontalization has pretty much begun, and COVID, if at all, has only been a catalyst to that process. What I mean by that statement is, over the last 20 years, you would track various opportunities and various opportunities to invest as well as to start up into different buckets. And technology was one of the many buckets. And over the last 10 years, it became a horizontal. And in a similar vein, I do feel that fintech is pretty much in the path to be a horizontal and less of a vertical. And the reason I say this is because you look at payments as a vertical, whether you look at credit as a vertical, every other business, if not every business, will have some of the other elements that are relevant, and you will end up building a stack or a layer of overlapping fintech ideas. So with that overarching thought process and context, we do see several areas in which the Indian and global ecosystem has evolved. We have the conventional financial services on one side with banking, insurance, capital markets, and we have a bunch of new initiatives on the payments, alternative areas of credit, crypto, etc. on the other side. So what I will try and do is bring in views of my fellow panelists here on each of these areas, starting with an area which has been in the news on and off, and something which most of us can't get our minds off. So broadly, the way we do see blockchain, crypto, it has been anointed as something that will take over future. There are economies which are being predicted to be built on top of cryptocurrencies. And there are also a lot of white papers, et cetera, floating around which say that the economies which don't adapt are definitely going to miss out on a lot. So let me start with my fellow panelists here. Going over to Ashish. Ashish, how do you see the developments here, and what are the areas we see blockchain creating sustainable enterprises? And in the vein of that, how do you see crypto emerging in India from here on? So that will be good to start with. And then, of course, we'll move the panel to understand other dynamics. Thanks, Ashish. Over to you.
Thanks, Ashish, for summarizing the fintech landscape in India. And obviously, crypto has been in the news and at the cutting edge of what we are trying to achieve as well, right? So crypto as an overarching theme in itself is trying to change fundamentally how systems work, right? creating less and less dependencies on third parties, creating more resilient systems which are built at the core by code itself and serving the people equally, right? Taking, say, insurance, for example, banking, for example, it becomes with just an internet and a mobile device, you can now access globally wherever you are the banking and the financial ecosystem. That is what crypto is here, you know, to revolutionize, to make every, not just everyone in the world, but every corners of India linked to this global ecosystem and trying to create different services in a new way possible. Right. So crypto is establishing a new way to build businesses, to take people into this economy through just a mobile phone and the internet and creating their own identity over this financial ecosystem. Crypto, especially in India, is very, very powerful, not from just the standpoint of investment, but also from the standpoint of the infrastructure. In India, you know, getting people on board on banking services, remote areas of India, it's hard. The infrastructure to build in India, it's very, very difficult to reach every single person on in India, even in the remotest area, to get them linked to the financial ecosystem. But crypto is that bridge that we believe working with the financial ecosystem, but creating a new way to onboard these people, to link these people to the economy and not just the local economy, but the global economy in itself, right? So crypto has emerged as a platform, not just as an investment platform in general, but as a platform to revolutionize banking, lending, insurance as we go on. Obviously, it's a very start of the journey. We'll see how things evolve in the future, but it's really promising how crypto could really benefit the world and especially India and you know, being so many innovators in India. Just looking forward to what we will come out and build the next set of you know, multi-billion dollar companies in India on crypto and blockchain.
Thanks, Ashish. Appreciate the views. So, David, coming to you next. In terms of taking this little forward, do we see crypto emerging as a mainstream activity which will take over being more than what today is being looked upon as an avenue, an asset class? And what are the critical factors for that to become mainstream, if at all you believe that way? And before we start, David, also a small 30 seconds introduction about you would be really useful for participants. Sorry, I missed that. With Ashish, we'll come back and do it again. So over to you, David. Thank you.
Sure. Just 30 seconds on me. I originally spent 12 years doing M&A at Yahoo, covering everything except for the US and then TBG Capital. And then I've been a partner at Jungle for the last 6 years. We invest in Series A, Series B tech companies across India and Southeast Asia. And like you, we also believe that fintech has always been, you know, horizontal. And within that, you have vertical categories from payments to credit that are building up. I think the other thing that's been evolving is that you also have, you know, years ago, you had defined, you know, fintech companies, where today I think there are fintech elements within all types of businesses. So you may have software businesses that have a payments or a credit or some other layer. You know, there's companies like Pine Labs. You have multifaceted businesses that have fintech as an element of what they're doing. So I think it's become more pervasive. I think as you think about crypto, you know, certainly there, as Ashish just mentioned, you know, there's a tremendous amount of benefits, you know, whether it's the velocity of transactions, the reduction of fraud. I think from an investor's perspective, I think one of the things that we are conscious of is the regulatory environment. And I think U.S. President Ronald Reagan had it right when he said, you know, the 9 most terrifying words in the English language are, "I'm from the government and I'm here to help." You know, so there is government involvement in crypto. There needs to be at a domestic level across all of the markets. And, you know, how that regulatory regime comes together really defines what role I think crypto can play in each of the individual markets. But clearly, you know, there are benefits and pros and cons to that. But, you know, as you think about the global applicability of crypto. It is, you know, one of the most pervasive technologies, I think, to grow globally, to align, you know, consumers and businesses in order to either transact or to drive more efficiencies in what they're doing, or make the world, you know, a smaller place and induce, you know, a lot more trade, a lot more continuity of service and consistency. So I think there is a tremendous amount of upside. I think it's still in the early days, and really is, you know, up for, you know, development based upon each individual domestic market.
Thanks, David. Appreciate. On that note, coming to Rajesh, a very relevant question, given what David mentioned about government. Is India ready for crypto? What are the factors we see are critical for crypto in India, if at all we believe they are ready? And if it is not, what are the path we need to walk?
Thanks, Ashish. Good question. I mean, India is has already tried to regulate it, in some ways ban crypto usage in India. Linking bank accounts to crypto exchanges, they took that step a couple of years back. I'm sure Ashish and others who are closer to crypto can answer that question maybe better. But in general, my views around crypto, of course, there are a lot of benefits. And when it comes to any sort of, whether it's currency or a financial services product, security is the most important thing, and speed of transactions is extremely important, and the price of the transaction is critical, right? So crypto does provide a lot of great advantages around all those three, but at the same time, the way, maybe it's a perception issue, maybe there is a way to semi-regulate the entire industry to make sure that crypto comes into the mainstream rather than a back channel currency the way it's looked upon today. My view is that the governments are not going to leave this particular industry alone without any regulation. I think from taxation to government revenues to many others. Maybe it's a perception issue. Excuse me.
Rajesh, please carry on. I think.
Okay. I think it'll be regulated to what extent by which government. Is there going to be an international body or individual country is going to regulate this on its own? I think there are a lot of complications ahead of crypto, and very difficult to kind of forecast how the whole industry is going to evolve. But my view is that it is going to be regulated. To what extent, and depending on the country, they may take different approaches to this. But if as the industry gets bigger, absolutely the governments are not going to let a lot of revenues leak, and there will be some regulation. I guess Ashish and others, I'm sure, are thinking about this on a daily basis, what the regulation is going to be. But it is going to be regulated.
No, just taking on that point, Rajesh, we are even expecting some developments on the tax front. Of course, the way the Indian laws define, they can tax on anything and everything. There's hardly anything that they can't. But we're expecting a little more clarification that this will be tax managed and regulated going forward. That's broadly the thought process in the news. And the other thing also is that I do feel that for that to be mainstream, the government will need to do better to give a clarity in terms of where its head is at. Do they want to have their own currency? Do they want to allow and permit other currencies to operate? I do feel that a lot more clarity and communication on the topic is going to do all of us a world of good. Till then, we can only imagine, speculate, and take our positions. But yeah, there's lots more to be done over the next 24 months or so before we can even start thinking of that becoming mainstream from an India standpoint, the way it is. So moving ahead, coming to Madhu. Madhu, from a payment, from a credit lens, what are the emerging trends leading to, and broadly, what is the way you see the landscape evolving? We have seen a fair bit of investment and growth of businesses around credit, and there seems to be an insatiable appetite both from the investor community and the in-state consumers who are leveraging these platforms. What is the way forward, and what does the future look like for us to have a holistic payment regulated system which can be managed, where this can be created in a sustainable format?
Hey, thanks, Ashish. On a level of some brief introduction, so I am Madhu, and I'm the CEO, co-founder of CreditBee. So CreditBee is a platform where we are intending to take the entire company towards a neobank services in next couple of years in its real sense. I mean, neobank is a certain term which has been abused very badly, but in its real sense, it's taking all the banking credit services to the last mile using technology as a platform, and that's what we aim to. Right. So, of course, you know, so what we have been doing for the last 5 years has been pioneering the lending, especially to the masses, especially to the tier two to tier four cities. Right. So T2 to T4 cities is what we have been servicing, providing the credit on top of a phone, on their apps, on their Android phones, is what we have been doing. Yeah. So looking at, you know, so credit, I mean, it's interesting to understand where India is. Right. So more than one third of the Indian population don't have banking services, the formal banking services, what we call it, right? So a huge part of India is dependent on the informal sectors. Just look at certain numbers, right? The health insurance, which is a primary need for all of us, the penetration of health insurance of any format is only about 18% to the Indians, right? So that's a basic need. The credit card penetration, for example, it has become more of an exclusive or a luxury service to be offered. The penetration is about like 3% to the Indians, right? So on one hand, what we see is that people like us keep getting tens of calls, or you know, there are like multiple times we get calls offering us credit cards, offering us personal loans, and offering us insurances and whatnot. And on the other hand, a lot of the masses have been deprived of these basic services, right? So that's where the real India is. Now, if you are looking at, you know, where the fintechs can majorly play a role, is not trying to go behind the crowd which has been already serviced so well by the banks, and they're kind of put into kind of a repeated calls by these banks and whatnot. Not those customers, but the customers who are really in this tier two to tier four cities, and that's where the real last mile services of this banking has to be provided. And that's where the real growth is going to come out. And otherwise, you don't really require to go and underwrite a salaried person with a 750 plus CIBIL score. I mean, there is no meaning in that. I mean, already the banks are doing, a fintech can never, or on a lending side, you can never offer the rates what the banks can offer. Then what are you kind really trying to chase here? Your CACs are going to shoot up, and ultimately there is no unit economics profitability, what you could see that. So in all sense, either the business sense or the real need within the Indian population, I think the mid-India or the T2 to T4 cities is where the growth going to come for in the future for the fintechs, is what is my thoughts. Yeah.
Thanks, Madhu. Appreciate. Anand, coming over to you with respect to payments, it has been one of the earliest breakouts from where India stands. And it has also emerged to be a fairly crowded market where there are a bunch of opportunities and avenues for customers and consumers alike. What do you see as the opportunity set next coming up? Do you see customers needing additional layers to be able to continue to engage with their preferred payment app? And if yes, what would these layers be, and how would the payment businesses differentiate?
It's a fantastic question, Ashish. And the whole idea of what is the preferred lens of payment for a consumer, and you called out early about the horizontalization of fintech. And I believe payment itself is one which is getting through the horizontal and applying itself to everything that exists. So every commerce gets expedited with a layer of super efficient payment mechanism, be it with a card swipe, with nil MDR, not relevant, with a UPI, with QR scan, not relevant for mass India, where debit cards are expired, mobile numbers are not updated in the bank account, bank hyper banking nahi. So that leaves you with cash or with pratyaksham ev pramanam. You put your thumb, and the old guard way of going back to the age old banking practices of putting thumb and getting your money done. That is what, by the way, we do 6,000 crore of throughput every month with $7 billion odd processed last year. That said, your first question is very interesting. The part where you ask that will the customer prefer the preferred mode of payment? The preference of a digital savvy greedy segment is the discount. And there is no loyalty warranted over there. So people are only burning money in doing habit formation changes where payment app A came and long live that. Payment app B came, long live wallet with UPI coming in. C, D, E, F, G came. And then the challenges of beyond T2 towns where debit cards are expired, where mobile numbers are not updated in the bank account. So how does one ride up to the UPI bandwagon either? Having said that, there is a mass India, the Bharat that you and I don't relate to, your mason, plumber, electrician, painter, carpenter, maid, aya, bai, and ABCD, everything that is substrata to us. And that segment is catching up gradually for lending, if you call it, neo-banking, if you call it, far away from crypto yet. Bhai, basic paisa to haath mein aane dijiye. So let the basic cash flow in. What I'm excited about is that the horizontalization of fintech applied to retailing with 15 lakh retailers registered on Pay Nearby platform without burning money, 50 lakh downloaded without burning money, and 500,000, 5 lakh of them actively transacting and serving. They're nothing but merchant network. So look at us as 500,000 retail network facilitating banking cash in, cash out. On top of it, you have a soft POS for tap and pay, you have a card swipe, you have a UPI, you have a Aadhaar Pay, and a link-based payment, not to miss out. On top of it, you engage layers of e-commerce, you engage layer of FMCG. So this is a transportation layer, a digital transportation layer of micro entrepreneurs seeded into deep arteries of India. And most of the work that you would talk of, two-way flow of communication, be it taking high-end of technology to the bottom of pyramid, which is payments, or taking e-commerce to assisted commerce, or taking the offload of the ground like Taobao in China. Can you help SHGs, self-help groups, to take their products online for sales at Amazon and ITC at Flipkart? So yeah, exciting times ahead, but 2 cents on the blockchain, since I can't hold, I heard Amitabh Chaudhary speaking in the previous session. What currency is it which is so much fluctuating? The basic dharma of currency is to be stable and give a stable commerce sense. CBDC would take the cake away when it comes, whenever it comes. Libra was held back for similar apprehensions probably. And what exchanges are those which fail offline often and take away the whole currency that is loaded onto them on crypto? No security warranted, $600 million taken away, 200 returned last week, I read about some exchange. So I don't understand this. I think we are far away from it, and we don't seem to be missing anything either. But the blockchain below it is a very great technology for a distributed ledger, which you can apply for many other things. Sorry, I don't understand it. Hence, I'm expressing my apprehension. And that's to you, Ashish.
No, appreciate this, Anand. Thanks for adding the last bit on the
Bitcoin
as well. Appreciate. So let me come back and bring in some investor views around what we are seeing as larger mega trends in the market as well. One segment that where not much was done initially was the infra space on the financial services side. Realistic innovation, that last innovation that I can recall on the banking side, having been part of a couple of banks, was core banking solution happening at scale. And it's been 2 decades since we spoke about that. A lot of tactical stuff, a lot of stuff on specific segments, but nothing at a scale that level. So what I'm definitely curious to know are, what are the trends we are seeing on the infra side, on applicable to financial services, banking, insurance, or any specific vertical within the financial services and fintech domain. Would love to start with you, David, and then also have Rajesh's view as from an investor lens before we go to the founders and have their thoughts.
Sure. So I think one of the biggest changes has been the leverageability of data. So if you think about that in the insurtech space, it's not just to Anand's point about the products reaching consumers in tier two or tier three towns and reaching a new base, but it's also leveraging the data that you're able to capture to drive and to create better underwriting, which hopefully lowers premiums and drives accessibility of certain products. And I think that's been largely prevalent in the insurtech space. So that's been a category that I think has been able to, and in the midst of transforming itself from, you know, traditional to new age, through the use of that data and through the benefits that technology brings. Maybe I'll pass over to Rajesh for his view on a bit more.
Thanks, David. I'll come back to you. I have a couple of points on the data bit.
Yeah.
That has been an engine driving a fair bit of hope and opportunity. I'll come back on that. But before that, I'm going to request Rajesh to come in on his thoughts on the overall trends and the opportunities in the fintech space, on specifically on the infra side, or any other thing that he has his views on what trends they're observing on the fintech side from a future standpoint. Rajesh, you're on mute.
Sorry. On the infrastructure side, I'm sure that there are a lot of fintechs, including a couple of our companies, who are building automation and other products for banks and large NBFCs. I don't see much innovation coming from the core banking sector. You're right, Ashish. Since the core banking, digital core banking. I don't think there's not much has happened. I think they're fat and happy, and I'm sure with the tech boom that we are seeing, I do notice through our portfolio companies, the larger banks are taking notice. They're trying to at least upgrade the technology. Does it mean they're going to develop everything in house, or are they going to go with the off-the-shelf cutting-edge products and platforms? They're at least trying. We have a company called SignZ, which does a lot of the workflow automation for banks and large NBFCs, including digital KYC, et cetera, which used to take weeks and months. For merchants, now we're doing it in a matter of minutes and hours, right? So there is some fundamentally performance and security and cost of transaction, like I mentioned before. All those areas, I think infrastructure upgrades are going to happen either by the banks themselves or by young entrepreneurs trying to innovate and sell it as a infrastructure products to large banks, to NBFCs, to like you said, I mean, the horizontal. Pretty much everyone is going to be NBFC eventually. So we need core infrastructure across, not just pure financial services companies, but it could be across many other players who will be dabbling in financial services, whether that's their core business or not. There may be a supply chain player and they'll be doing payments and lending, and it could be many other segments, right? So. It's not their core business. So infrastructure can be provided by fintech companies as a horizontal to many of these players where it's not their core asset or skill set. So there are many examples like Credit Vidya, which does differentiated credit scoring, and we do that for pretty much every large bank and every large NBFC out there. It's not that the banks and NBFCs cannot do, but just the innovation of applying, taking a few data points without bothering the customer too much. And how do you apply AI and data science and figure out whether they're credit-worthy or not, right? So there are a lot of things happening all around the financial services. It's not just about payments and lending, right? I mean, those are the things which get talked about. But this fundamentally infrastructure side, things have to change. And it's a matter of time, either the banks do it themselves or the reason new banks exist is because banks cannot provide simple digitization and extending it to every customer who wants banking to their doorstep, right? So now you're at your fingertips. So the fintechs and the entrepreneurs, the new age entrepreneurs are going to put a lot of pressure on the entire system to innovate or at least buy off the shelf platforms and products to make their whole process much more smoother and faster.
Thank you. I think one very pertinent point you made is about payments and lending is not the only thing. And that's where the earlier boom came in. And thanks to the last few years, we are seeing a slightly more balanced attention to the infrastructure as well, without which I don't think we'll be able to get to a lot of solutions. Things as basic as reconciliations, or things as whether it is a credit card for their merchants or whether it is the customers for the banks. We still are in areas where there's a lot of scope on those areas. And that's where I think even the best of the new banks will have to think through some of these to become more holistic and own the customer as well as being able to have meaningful margin structures for themselves. So coming to you, would be good to start with a quick 30-second background about you and the company. And rather than putting my question for you, I'll crowdsource it. There has been a fair bit of interest and people are asking questions, so let me use that. So the question that was put up was, how do you as a company look at the technology and the security related concerns relating to crypto? And the other part, also what I thought relevant, what I've been meaning to check with you, is about the cost of transactions. So would be good to hear your thoughts.
Thanks, Ashish. And just to introduce myself, Ashish Singhal, CEO and co-founder of CoinSwitch Kuber, which is the leading crypto platform in India, making crypto as investing as simple as ordering food online. And just before I answer your question, Ashish, I want to address Anand's point as well on, that it's, we believe.
I was about to ask you on that when I said, let me crowdsource. Thanks for being
here. Sure. So we are not so probably close to crypto. So we do not understand who are actually investing in crypto. 60% of our users, which is over 6 million users, are coming from tier 2 and tier 3 cities. My maid invests in crypto as well. My parents invest in crypto. Obviously, they're biased, but they invest in crypto. And tier 2, tier 3 cities are the big hubs which are getting into this investment. And crypto is not just about CBDCs, it's about stable coins. Why Bitcoin fluctuates so much? Why did gold fluctuate so much when it was starting to accept as a payment? Because once you figure out that there is a mode of payment, then every region had different demand and supply, and demand and supply need to equate for this fluctuation to go away. Crypto is in an adoption phase. This fluctuation will reduce and stabilize over time. Stable coins are a solution. It has been implemented across the world through various like USDC, USDT, and various other factors, which plays a very critical part. But that critical part is not what blockchain and crypto is all about. It's about building infrastructure. It's about creating more solutions. Like Ashish talked about reconciliation. Identity is one of them. Cross-border remittance among them, and micropayments, which I now talk about regarding the cost of transaction, Ashish, to address your point. So cost of transaction on crypto obviously fluctuate too much because of the network issues. It's a new network which is trying to build up now. But over time, things like Lightning Network, things like sidechain would reduce the amount of transactions on the actual blockchain, reducing the amount of cost and enabling micropayments. If you have to pay even 1 rupee to continuously, say, stream a YouTube video from any point, you can still do that without worrying about the cost of transaction in that mode, right? So these are the, like people used to say, right, that internet, money for the internet has never been built. And Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies, what they're trying to do is trying to establish that infrastructure which will allow payment to happen smoothly over the internet. And cost of transaction is a very important point to address there. And things like Lightning Network, things like, you know, side chains would considerably reduce the cost of doing transactions over, you know, the networks built on blockchains itself. And we would see traditional finance using blockchain in the future to reduce their transaction cost. And remittance is a very good example for that. Remittance cost and time has reduced significantly, you know, since the banks have started using blockchain as their base to, you know, send and receive information in and around the SWIFT message, right? Coming to security, obviously security is the biggest risk, because once you take away, you know, currently in the current financial ecosystem, you trust banks and third parties to be secure, to take care of your security. Crypto works the other way. The security lies in the hand of the people that holds it. So security is going to be a big challenge, but it's not that, you know, we haven't done enough. The industry has moved bounds beyond traditional security. And, you know, Coinbase custody is a great example, even a Faraday cage of they have built to make sure that the information sharing is not possible across any network, making the most secure crypto storage in the world today. Right. So it's about innovation. And as the innovation grows, our need for security would grow. And, you know, the young companies like us would try to build new innovative systems, making sure that people feel secure and safe while using these infrastructures and still be able to utilize the best possible outcome from the infrastructure that built out.
Good points. Appreciate, Ashish. Thanks a lot. Just a quick 10 seconds before I move to the last couple of questions. David, thanks for your time. I understand you need to leave. Really appreciate your time and insights. Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you. It was a great panel.
So, Madhu, a very quick question. The perpetual argument about every lending to credit business will eventually need to have an NBFC versus platforms will have the scope to become profitable on their own without the NBFC, the bank aid. So very quick, short view before we move to the last question to Anand.
Yeah, so I guess, you know, the models are really becoming quite evolved, right? So there is NBFCs which are participating on multiple platforms, and you know, there are companies like us who run both the platform and an NBFC. So our platform has multiple NBFCs, banks participating on our own platform, while our NBFC participates on multiple other platforms. So you will see a lot of M cross N structures that will evolve and probably gets enticing, and that's how the industry is evolving, right? So there's never been a single bank in any country, right? So there are always, it's not a winner take all market, especially in terms of credit. There's going to be multiple players and there's going to be multiple platforms, and the coexistence and growing together is the way for fintech lending sectors, right? So that's what we are going to eventually see in this sector. So the presence is what is more important. And coming to that part of, you know, so who is going to be profitable here, whether the NBFC or the platform, I think the real question is who is going to underwrite. You know, so the overall point comes in is that NBFC is nothing but a regulatory license at the end of the day, which probably the platforms itself can apply and whatnot, right? So the real question comes is who is underwriting, and whether that particular platform or NBFC has the ability to underwrite with the data available on that platform, right? So I think that's the key question, and that's where somebody has to build their expertise on. And those are the entities which will be valued more in the upcoming time or in future, rather than to very clearly say that whether the NBFCs or the platforms and who will dictate the terms is more about who can underwrite here. Yeah.
Good point. Thank you. Anand, last question. I do feel that the world will be a more holistic system with the new age tech players existing coincided with the existing ecosystem on financial services. I don't think it is true that bank branches will be replaced. It will be coexisting, it will be more sophisticated. Quick thoughts on that before we hand it back to Saurabh.
I believe it's a model of coexistence. It's not anti-existence. Everyone has a job to do. We believe that the fintechs are the front office of banks, so to say, rather than thinking banks are back office of fintechs. There is a lot of governance. There is a lot of credibility, trust that they bring. That said, yeah, bank, NBFC, fintechs, non-lending ones also, all of them will coexist. And it's even Rajesh mentioned, and even I heard Madhu say that it's a matter of coexistence. What of each other can you leverage? So 2+2 is not 4, it's actually 40, if that is what you can leverage. Having said that, to your own point that you mentioned about horizontalization earlier rather than verticalization of payment, we see a huge opportunity with these 500,000 active retailers. We are now able to take ITC on our backfill to the remotest of the areas. We are able to take an e-commerce company there. We are able to take pharmacy to the last mile while simultaneously handling banking and payments, all the payment modules on top of it, lending enabled with terabytes of data that are available, with human intelligence and we call it Bharosa score. It's not credit score, it's credibility score. Because 100 customers come to our retailer base every month, on month. So there is a credibility established through our data that we are able to see. We experimented it with Centrum, and we see 3 cycles of repayment happening 100%. So this is a scalable model. Imagine 5 lakh retailers getting 50,000 rupees. It will be one of the good large portfolios created out of it. Now, that said, to your point that infra was built in the last 2 years, Rome was not built in a year. And overnight, the UPI today enjoys the bedrock of IMPS, which was built 10 years ago, which rode on NEFT. Simultaneously came a spin-off of Aadhaar-enabled payment system, where when the cards were not working, Aadhaar was working. When the ATMs were down underwater, or the ATM cards were not working, the Angutha Chhap was working actually, and people, you and I, also withdrew using Aadhaar system. So coexistence, interdependency is a better way. Lot has been built. And like you say, we are a digital connector. These are 500,000 micro entrepreneur platforms who help bring anything to anywhere. So while we say most of the financial services to most of the people at most of the places, it looks like with digital connectivity, we can take most of the things to most of the people.